I will leave Olivia take the stage. Our first speaker today is Olivia Caramello from Università dell'Insubria, who will talk about relative topos theory via stacks. So, Olivia, welcome. Okay. The stage is yours.
Yeah, thanks a lot for the invitation. So I'm going to give you an overview of our work in progress on relative topos theory in the language of stats that we have been pursuing with Riccardo Zanfa, who is one of my PhD students, throughout the last 2 years. So this is a quite big project, and we shall release the first version of our work in the next days. So I'm going to survey some of our main results, but of course you will find much more material in the text that we shall make available. Okay, so what's the topic we are going to address? We are going we are going to provide new foundations for relative topos theory by using the language of stacks. So I shall first introduce the main philosophy of our approach. Then I shall recall some preliminaries, which will be necessary for understanding our results. Then I shall present the big picture, which as you will see is a wide network of adjunctions on which our theory is based, so that this gives the broad setting in which we work. And then I shall focus on describing the key ingredients of this big picture, in particular a fundamental adjunction that we shall establish between relative toposes and indexed categories. We shall see that this will represent a wide extension of the classical Prichet-Bandel adjunction for topological spaces, which of course, as you know, plays a key role in providing a geometric understanding of sheaves and related constructions. Then we shall talk about relative sheaf toposes. As we shall see, the approach we are following is that of Giraud, who introduced the classifying topos of a stack, which in fact provides the kind of relative pre-sheaf toposes. But then, of course, it is natural also to define relative sheaf toposes as subtoposes of those toposes. So we shall conclude with that. And in the context of our presentation, we are going also to describe some applications. We shall see that our theory actually provides an answer to a question asked by Grothendieck himself in the 70s in his Buffalo course about the possibility of geometrically understanding toposes as a sort of petit toposes associated with Groth toposes, sharing with them crucial properties. So we shall see that our approach, provides also a solution to this problem, which was raised by Grothendieck and which was recently brought to the public attention by Colin McLarty. Okay, so let's first talk about the philosophy of our work. The aim is to develop tools for doing topos theory over an arbitrary based topos. So to develop relativity techniques, change of base techniques, such as the ones that play such an important role in the Grothendieckian algebraic geometry for schemes. But here the idea is to have such tools for toposes. So this problem is something that has been addressed since the very beginning of topos theory by several researchers. So one of the main researchers that worked on the subject was Giraud, student of Grothendieck, who introduced this fundamental construction of classifying topos of a stack in his paper, in fact, named Classifying Topos. Then also a number of category theories, Lovier, sorry, there are some spelling problems here, Lovier, Diaconescu, Johnston, etc., also addressed this subject from a different elementary point of view, and developed an approach based on the notions of internal category and internal size. In fact, this approach has not really led to applications of relative topos theory so much in different areas of mathematics. And we think that the reason for this is that this formalism of internal categories and internal sites is really too rigid. Also, it's not general enough to naturally capture relative topos theoretic phenomena. In particular, the problem is that when you have an internal category or an internal site, basically all the information is concentrated in single objects, and you don't have really a natural vibrational viewpoint, which is fundamental if you want to formalize parametric reasoning, which is so important in the context of relativity techniques. So in fact, after dealing a bit with these notions, at the beginning we were thinking about developing our theory based on these notions, but then we realized that they were really not very satisfactory for the aims we had, which is really to have a user-friendly theory which can be applied in different areas of mathematics. In fact, we realized that most of the stacks that naturally arise in mathematics, in geometric situations especially, even though, of course, they can always be presented as internal categories because every stack is equivalent to a split stack, namely to an internal category, but actually this rigidification process is not at all natural from a mathematical viewpoint. And so these notions of internal category and internal site really are very, very rigid for applications. So we have indeed decided to resort to the original approach introduced by Giraud, which since then had been more or less forgotten, it must be said, because really very, very few people developed starting from that. So this was our starting point. And now let's explain how stacks play a role in our approach. So basically stacks are important for multiple reasons. In fact, there are two main roles that they play in our theory. So on the one hand, stacks can be seen as generalizations of sheaves. Mm? So as you consider sheaves on a site, you can consider stacks on a site. And basically the notion of stack is a higher order analog of the notion of sheaf. Mm? So as you have Grothendieck toposes, namely categories which are equivalent to categories of sheaves on a site, also you have categories of stacks on a site, and you can expect them to satisfy some formally similar properties to the ones we are familiar with for Grothendieck toposes. So this is one point of view that one can have on stacks. But there is another one which is crucial in relation to relative topos theory, which is the fact that we can regard stacks on a given site as a weaker notion of internal category in the corresponding topos of sheaves on that site. Therefore, since we are used to put topologies on categories to form sites, we are induced also to put analogs of Grothendieck topologies on stacks, so to form relative sites. So we shall give a notion of relative site towards the end of the talk. Okay, so you see that these two different perspectives are quite distinct, but of course they are interrelated, as we are going to see very, very deeply. Okay, so now here is the network of adjunctions on which our theory is based. So basically the main result on which we are going to build is the adjunction you see on the first line between, so we fix a site, a small generated site CJ, and then we consider on the one hand the indexed categories, indexed by C, the category underlying the site, and on the other hand, the category of relative toposes over the base topos, which is going to be the topos of sheets on our site. So here, just a few precisions. So I'm not going to address size issues. There are some size issues here, which can be solved in different ways. Either one uses Grothendieck universes, or one restricts to some smaller categories, but I don't have enough time to deal with this. So I will just present the big picture, and then you will find all the details in the paper. Anyway, so we have these two big categories, and we are going to relate them with two functors, which are going to be adjoint one to the other in a two categorical sense. So in fact, these are precisely the functors which provide a point-free site-theoretic generalization of the usual pre-sheaf bundle adjunction for topological space. So in fact, you see index categories actually generalized pre-sheaves, in particular pre-sheaves on a topological space, and relative toposes generalize bundles. So, okay, so this is the first line of the diagram. Then, of course, we can restrict to stacks on our site. And of course, we know that stacks are related to index categories by an inclusion functor, which has a left adjoint, which is the stackification functor. On the other hand, we can remark that actually our functor lambda takes values in the subcategory of essential geometric morphisms, and so one can restrict to essential morphisms. And so this gives the category S topos, which is written there. And so basically we have a restriction of our adjunction at that level, because in fact one can show that the gamma functor, which generalizes the global section functor, actually takes values in stacks. So it always gives a stack, as it happens in the case of topological spaces, because when you have a bundle and you construct the sheaf of cross sections of this bundle, indeed you get a sheaf. So what is going on here is formally perfectly analogous. Then there are sheaves, which are also related to stacks, because we can regard them, we can embed them in stacks, and also we can generate sheaves from stacks by means of a truncation operation, which in fact can be realized by composing the gamma functor in the adjunction with the function, the functor E, which sends an essential geometric morphism to the object given by evaluating the essential image of the morphism at the terminal object of the topos. So by composing the two functors, E and the restriction of lambda, one gets a sort of truncation functor, which starting from a stack, essentially gives the best sheaf approximation to it. Okay, so this is the general picture. Now we are going to get into the details of all of this. And for this, I'm going to recall some preliminaries. So we have to recall the notions of morphisms and comorphisms of sites. In fact, when you do topos theory, say from an algebraic point of view, the perspective of morphisms of site is the one that is most natural. So when you present, when you think of toposes, for instance, as generalizations of frames, actually the point of view of morphisms of sites is the most natural one for like dealing with generators, relations, etc. So it is a sort of algebraic point of view. In this talk, we are going to focus more on the other point of view, the point of view on toposes provided by comorphisms of sites. And this is a dual point of view, which I would call geometric. So it's really a geometric perspective on toposes. So in fact, continuous comorphisms of sites can be seen as a natural categorical analog of continuous maps of topological spaces, while morphisms of sites are a kind of more combinatorial functor between toposes. Okay, so the technical definitions are these. So a morphism of sites is a functor which actually induces a geometric morphisms between the corresponding shift toposes in the converse direction in a natural way, in the sense that it fits in, I mean, the inverse image of this morphism and the original morphism of sites are related by a commutative diagram whose vertical functors are the canonical functors going from the site to the toposes. Okay, so this is the abstract definition. Of course, morphisms of size can also be characterized in purely combinatorial elementary terms, but we are not going to use this in the talk, so I'm not going to report this, this description here. Comorphisms of sites are defined as functors which have the covering lifting property. So this means that whenever one has a covering sieve on an object in the image of the functor, it is possible actually to lift this cover to a covering sieve on that object in such a way that indeed the image of this sieve under the functor is contained in the sieve. Okay, it's important also for our purposes to talk about continuity for functors between sites. So this is a notion which was introduced by Grothendieck, but which had been a bit forgotten by most category theorists. You will not find many evidences of this notion in the categorical literature, but it is a very important notion, as we are going to see. And also a very natural one. You see, the definition is this: the functor is continuous if composing with it preserves the sheaf property. So basically, the functor DA given by composition with AOP restricts to a functor between the subcategory of sheaves. Okay, now, as I anticipated, we are going to focus on comorphisms of sites. In fact, we are going to consider continuous comorphisms of sites because they are strictly related to vibrations. In general, for any functor A going to from a category C to a category D, and any Grothendieck topology K on D, one can define a topology on the domain category on C, characterized by the property of being the smallest topology, making the given functor a comorphism of sites to the site dk. Now, Now, in general, this topology doesn't admit a very explicit description. I mean, it admits a description in terms of generators, but not like a compact description of exactly what are the covering seats. Still, in the particular case of a vibration, indeed, it is possible to get a compact description of it in terms of Cartesian arrows in the vibration. More precisely, a sieve is covering for such a topology if and only if the collection of the Cartesian arrows in it is assigned by the functor to a covering family. We shall call this topology the Giraud topology induced by the topology on the base category D. Why? Well, because in fact this topology was used by Giraud in constructing the classifying topos of a stack. So, in fact, he defined precisely the classifying topos of a stack as the topos of sheaves on the stack with respect to this topology. And as we shall see in a minute, this classifying topos of stacks represent the analog in the relative setting of pre-sheaved topos. Before talking about this, let me remark that when you deal with vibrations or morphisms of vibrations and you endow them with these topologies, you end up with continuous comorphisms of sites. So this is important because the continuity of a comorphism of sites has a consequence for the geometric morphism induced by it, because whenever you have a continuous comorphism of sites, the corresponding morphism is essential. In some situations, it is even locally connected. In particular, the morphisms which are induced by vibrations are always locally connected. This is not true for arbitrary morphisms of vibrations, but it's true for vibration. So in particular, all Giraud topos are locally connected over the base. Okay, Giraud topologies are very good. They have this very explicit description, as we have seen, and they can be used to investigate the properties of indexed categories, because of course the construction can be applied to an arbitrary indexed category. And in particular, we have several results which connect properties of the Giraud topology with the properties of the given vibration. So here is an example. So suppose we have a subcanonical site and a Cloven vibration, then this vibration is a pre-stack if and only if the Giraud topology is subcanonical. So this is an illustration of this very nice interplay between properties of this topology and properties of the vibration. So actually the construction of the Giraud topology, as you can expect, can be made factorial, actually two factorial. So we actually have a Giraud topology functor, which actually endows a vibration with the Giraud topology. And in this way, of course, we get a morphism of size by the very definition of Giraud topology. By the results we have mentioned, in fact, this Giraud topology functor takes values in the subcategory of continuous comorphism of size. Okay, so now let's talk about what happens at the topos theoretic level, starting from such functors. So we first recall that every morphism of sites induces a geometric morphism going in the other direction. What is important for us is that every comorphism of sites also induces a geometric morphism. And if the comorphism is continuous, actually this geometric morphism is essential. And moreover, if it is, if the functor is moreover a vibration, this morphism is even locally connected. Now, morphisms of sites still are very important for studying and working with geometric morphisms of topologies, because every morphism of topologies can actually be seen as a morphism of sites, in the sense that you take the inverse image of the morphism, and this you see it is a finite finite limit preserving functor, which is also cover preserving, and therefore it is a morphism of sites, and the morphism the geometric morphism which it induces is precisely our morphism. So this perspective is very, very important. We are going to apply it in the next slide. Before applying this to the setting of an arbitrary geometric morphism, I have to recall some results from my monograph on denseness conditions for topologies. Written last year. So one of these results that we are going to apply is the construction of comorphisms of sites starting from morphisms of sites in such a way that they induce the same morphism. So it's a sort of a bridge. This is very useful because, of course, it has many applications in different contexts, because you see, as morphisms of sites represent a sort of algebraic point of view on morphisms, while comorphisms represent a geometric point of view, as you can imagine, being able to pass from one to the other can be very, very useful in practice. And we are going to present an application of this in a moment. So how does this work? So supposing that you have a morphism of small generated sites F from Cj to Dk, well, the idea is very simple. You consider the comma category. One D comma F, and the canonical projection to C. One can prove that this is a comorphism of sites, which actually induces the same morphism induced by the original morphism of sites, as pictured in the triangle at the bottom of the slide. So you see there are equivalences between different presentations of the same topos. And under these equivalences, the morphism induced by F gets identified with the morphism induced by pi C, which is the canonical projection, namely the comorphism attached to this morphism. So of course this can be applied to an arbitrary geometric morphism through the morphism of size canonically associated with that. So in this way we get the canonical projection functor, which is a comorphism of size inducing our geometric morphism. Now this functor is actually very important for several reasons. First of all, we should remark that it is a stack. In fact, it is called the canonical stack of the morphism. This was already introduced by Giraud in his paper and plays a crucial role there. So it works like this. From an indexed viewpoint, it sends an object E of the topos to the relative topos. So F relative to F upper star of E, and acts on arrows just by pullback. Okay, now we can specialize this to the identity in particular. And in this way, we get what is called the canonical stack of a topos. Or if you choose a site of definition for this topos, you get the so-called canonical stack on that site. And this is the pseudo functor sending any object of the category underlying the site to the corresponding relative topos. So look here, I mentioned at the beginning that internal categories were indeed too rigid to capture important relative phenomena. And here is an illustration. You see the canonical stack of a topos is not an internal category. So it's really a stack because there are non-trivial isomorphisms existing. And so it is a pseudo functor. Okay, so this is interesting because if we look at the application of the above result to the identity morphism, we get actually an equivalence between an arbitrary topos of sheaves on a site and a topos of sheaves on the canonical stack for that site with respect to a given topology, which can be made completely explicit. And we can regard this actually as a sort of a thickening of the usual representation of a Grothendieck topos as the category of sheaves on its canonical site. So here we have something richer. We have we are considering really the topos of sheaves on some stack. So this is an example of a relative site. So we are going to give the notion of relative site at the end of the talk, but here we already have an example and a very important one, which in fact can be used for many applications, in particular representation theorems for relative topologies, analogs of Giraud theorem for relative topologies, etc. So this result is a lot of applications. Okay, so now let's talk about the classifying topos of the stack, or more generally, the Giraud topos associated with an indexed category. So we are going to use this terminology. So given an indexed category, we denote by G of it, the vibration associated with it through the Grothendieck construction. And of course, in this way, we get a vibration over the base category, and we denote by P of D, the canonical projection functor. Okay, so there is one result which shows that indeed Giraud's construction of the classifying topos of the stack really gives the good analog of the notion of pre-shift topos on a category. So this is a result in our work, which represents a wide generalization of a result already contained in Giraud's paper. So what does this proposition say? It says that if we consider a small generated site CJ, an indexed, a C index category D, and its opposite, which is defined just by taking the opposite at each of each fiber, then one has a natural equivalence between the Giraud topos and this category of pseudo functors going from the opposite of D to the canonical stack. So you see that this really generalize pre-shifts. You see pre-shifts, you take values in sets. Here you take values in the canonical stack of the topos, because you want to do topos theory relative to a base topos. So you replace the topos of sets with an arbitrary topos, which in our case is the topos of sheaves on CJ. Okay, so this proposition indeed reassures us to the fact that Giraud's construction is the right one if we want to define relative pre-shift topologies. We shall see that, in fact, the Giraud topos can be seen as a weighted colimit of a diagram of et al. Topologies over the base topos. This is also interesting because it represents a sort of analog of the possibility of representing, pre-sheaves as colimits of representables. Okay, but we are going to explain this now in more detail. So first we recall the notion of a weighted pseudo-colimit. So here, of course, we are in the setting of two categories. And so one defines a weighted pseudo-colimit as a universal weighted cocoon. So a weighted cocoon is visualized here in the slides. So it's a quite a thick kind of structure because you don't have just one leg for each object, but you have several legs which can be related to each other by two morphisms. So this is the universal property characterizing weighted pseudo-colimits. So the pseudo condition is what makes the two morphisms F, Y, U, the ones you see in the diagonal there, isomorphisms. If you don't require that, you get the notion of a lax weighted colimit. Okay, so our result, which I anticipated, says indeed that for any cloven fibration, or equivalently for any indexed category, the Giraud topos can be expressed as the weighted pseudo-colimit of a diagram of et al. Topologies, where the weight is given by the index category itself. So here I have just rewritten the universal property of weighted colimits. So you see that there is an equivalence on the one end between on the one end the morphisms of relative topologies over the base topos, and on the other end the morphisms of indexed categories from the canonical stack to the topos, and this holds for any relative topos E. So when I say sheaves on CJ topos, I mean that it is a morphism. It is a morphism with codomain sheaves on CJ. Okay, so we have that. And so more precisely, this is what is going on. So we have this pseudo weighted this weighted pseudo-colimit of et al. Topologies, which, well, here they are represented like this, but they are indeed et al. Topologies over the base topos because they are topologies over the images of the objects X and Y in the topos. And you see that why there are several legs here, because basically each leg corresponds to an object of the fiber. So you see, in general, you will have, so you fix an object as the X, and of course you have several objects in the fiber D of X. And by the fiber, the Yonida lemma, each of these objects gives rise to a morphism of fibrations, which give rise in turn to a comorphism of sites, And so each of them will give us a leg. So these legs is what I have written, lambda x u. So you see they are indexed by the objects of the category of the Grothendieck category of the five dimension. And you also see clearly why we have a pseudo colimit, because these canonical two morphisms are actually isomorphisms, what I have written there. Okay, so in fact, here we have a weighted pseudo colimit at the level of toposes, but in fact, this such a weighted colimit representation already holds at the level of categories over C, or continuous comorphisms of sites over C. So actually what happens here is the image of something which happens at the site level by means of the construction associated with a comorphism of sites, the corresponding geometric morphism.
Okay. Olivia, sorry to interrupt you. You have a few minutes to wrap up before the time ends.
Okay, thank you. Yes, because I didn't pay attention to, so I have 10 minutes, something like, because we started a bit late, so I don't remember exactly.
In theory, you will have spoken for 45 minutes in 4 minutes, starting
four
now.
4 minutes, okay. So I will be very quick, thank you.
You can decide if you want to take some time from the question time, but then there will be less time for questions.
Okay, no, I understand. Okay, so I will try to do my best. In any case, so here is the fundamental adjunction. So in fact, this is just due to the universal property of weighted pseudocolimits. So there is nothing more than that. But it is interesting because it makes appear two pseudo-functors, gamma and lambda, which indeed provide natural analogs of what we have in the setting of pre-Schiff bundle adjunction for topological space. Okay, indeed, here there are a few slides which concern the specialization of these two pre-Schiffs, so to discrete vibrations. And indeed, here we can appreciate that the development is completely similar to what we have for topological spaces. So we have an adjunction of one categories. And in fact, as in the topological setting, we have, for instance, a home functor, which represents a sort of global section functor. And the functor lambda, which represents the analog of the bundle of germs of a pre-Schiff. So it is a natural generalization of that. Notice that one outcome of this is a completely point-free understanding of these constructions, which is not a priori completely straightforward. Okay, so here are just a few other formal properties which are perfectly analogous to what happens in the setting of topological spaces. In particular, the Schiffification operation can be realized by composing the two functors in the fundamental. And this is very interesting because it gives us a geometric perspective on Schiffification, perfectly analogous to the one we had in the topological set. Of course, this has a lot of applications. So here are just a few which I have listed. So the geometric perspective on Schiffification, which naturally connects with the description of the Schiffification in terms of local imaging families of elements of a pre-Schiff, which is, in my opinion, a much more illuminating perspective on this functor than the plus-plus construction. So we have that, and indeed we can identify the elements of the Schiffification with geometric morphisms, which in fact can be locally represented as induced by morphisms of vibrations. And so this is precisely where the link with local imaging family strikes through. Okay, other applications we have, for instance, very nice descriptions in terms of vibrations of direct and inverse images of receives or sheets. And in fact, these results also extend in the context of stacks. Mm? And yeah, so for details, you can refer to our paper. Okay, so finally, relative toposis. We have talked about relative pre-shift toposis, I mean, the analog of pre-shift toposis in the relative setting. So since every topos is a subtopos of a pre-shift topos, so every relative topos should be a subtopos of a relative pre-shift topos. And so we define a site relative to a base topos as a pair consisting of an index category and of a Grothendieck topology on its Grothendieck construction containing the Giraud topology. Mm? Recall that subtoposes of a certain topos of sheaves on a certain site correspond to the Grothendieck topology on the category underlying the site containing the given Grothendieck topology. Okay, now one can wonder if it is possible to work effectively with these relative sites. Well, the answer is yes. In fact, one cannot really simplify and reduce relative sites to things happening entirely at the horizontal or the vertical level. Because in fact, we have a mixture between horizontal and vertical components. So one thing that should be said is that many relative topologies which arise in practice are actually generated by purely horizontal or purely vertical data. For instance, this is the case for the total topology of a fiber site in the sense of Grothendieck or the Giraud topology itself, which is entirely generated by horizontal data. Still, there are very interesting topologies arising, for instance, in the context of comma toposes or, say, the overtopos at a model, which is a current, a recent work with Axel Osmond. So there we introduced actually a mixed topology in which there is a very nice interplay between horizontal and vertical components. And this also generalizes to the context of comma toposes. And something that that was very pleasant in that work was that we managed to find an explicit description of the basis for that topology. In general, computing basis for topologies generated by different sets of data is not straightforward. But in fact, we were able to get a very nice description of basis. And then in this work with Riccardo, we have gone further on and we have generalized this method to provide explicit descriptions of bases for a wide class of relative topologies generated by horizontal and vertical. Okay, finally, I want to say a word about this problem of Grothendieck I mentioned at the beginning. This has to do with Groth entity topologies. So for this, we need to recall the notion of local morphism. You see, when you have Groth and Petit toposes, in fact, they are related, they are typically related by local, by a local retraction, which in fact make them homotopically equivalent, and therefore it is responsible for the fact that they share the same cohomological invariants. Mm? So local morphisms play a crucial role in the context of Groth and Petit toposes. And in fact, why is the problem posed by Grothendieck related to Groth and Petit toposes? Well, because Grothendieck asked for essentially a way for geometrically thinking about a topos as it were a generalized space. Now, in geometry, petit toposes tend to be the toposes which can be thought as generalized spaces, as opposed to Groth toposes, which are normally conceived as toposes as categories of spaces. Mm-hmm. And so the point would be, can we view every Grothendieck topos as some kind of petit topos associated with a very big topos in a formally analogous way, as we do in geometry in constructing, say, the petit and gros topos of Zariski, etc. Is it possible to do that? So that was what Grothendieck asked. Well, most precisely, he asked whether it is possible to, in some sense, view objects of a topos as something being etal spaces over the final object of the topos, and seeing the induced topos as the object itself, etc. So apparently there were not yet the tools to make a perfect sense of all of this, but thanks to the framework we have developed, we can indeed build a pair of gros and petit toposes which answer this question. This is based on the introduction of a new topology on the category of toposes, which we call the etal cover topology, and which represents an analog of the open cover topology for topological spaces. And by equipping the category of toposes with this etal cover topology, we indeed get a big topos in which we can embed our original topos through some inclusion which actually gives a retract, and the retraction is given by a local morphism. And so in fact, this is an application of a result which I proved in my monograph about inducing local morphisms of topos. So it is this result here. Mm? So when you have a functor which is relatively faithful and relatively full, and which is simultaneously a morphism and a comorphism of sides, then it induces a local morphism. So we apply that, and we are able actually to build what seems to us is a setting that would have satisfied Grothendieck. Okay, so here are the two main references. So there is this manuscript in preparation, which we shall release in the next few days on the archive. And for some of the results we used, you can refer to the monograph, which I put on archive last year. Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you. And finally, an invitation to join us at the forthcoming Toposes Online conferences. So I know many of you will give presentations there. So I look forward to that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So I think we have time to thank the speaker, and silently, of course. And just for an extremely quick question before the next speaker, if someone has something to ask.
I have a question. I would give priorities to the other attendees, but in case I have a question. Okay, if no one wants to take my spot. So there is I think it's very deep result in topos theory, which is that every topos is localic over set O.
Yes.
So this result is telling us that in a sense, every topos is petite with respect to this internal locale that sits inside set O. And this also has very logical interpretations that maybe we don't comment now.
Yeah. In fact, my student, Joshua Wrigley, will give a talk specifically on that at the Toposes Online conference. He introduced a new notion, that of a localic diagram, which generalizes the notion of an internal locale in a pre-shift topos. And in fact, this is very interesting also from the point of view of the theory developed here, because in fact, when you want to construct the topos of ships on an internal locale, or more generally, the topos of ships on a localic diagram, in the sense of Wrigley. In fact, you end up with a relative topology.
Yeah, this is what I wanted to ask. This is what I wanted to ask precisely: what's the connection between these results, which is due to Freit, to my knowledge, and mm-hmm. and because in a sense this is already a partial answer to Grothendieck ask, because you are presenting every topos as a localic topos over something. So it's petit with respect to a locale, which in fact is the hyper doctrine associated to the.
Yes, it is the hyper doctrine. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
It seems to be quite different, because here you have pairs of Gros and Petit toposes, so you don't deal with localic morphisms, you deal with local morphisms that are different. So I don't think it's related to that, but it is certainly related with relative sites, because you get a very nice explicit description of a relative topology which presents that. And in fact, again, you see also in that setting that restricting to internal things is really too restrictive, because you see, you can present localic morphisms, not just by internal locales, but more generally by using localic diagrams in the sense of Wrigley. So a localic diagram is simply a functor from a category to the category of locales. Nothing more. So you don't have Frobenius conditions or Beck-Chevalet conditions, which are implied in the notion of an internal locale. Still, it should be possible, and I think Josh is investigating that, to construct an internal locale from a localic diagram as a sort of completion of that.
I'm looking forward to this talk. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I think we have to stop the discussion here to give space to the next speaker. I guess we can thank Olivia again for the talk.
Thanks to you.
And okay, let's move on to